We had recently in the last year in August, NBFC issues, right? Liquidity squeezes came afterwards because one of the largest infrastructure lender, ILFS, defaulted on their commercial paper. And, then we saw a huge liquidity crisis in India. And how did that, you navigated through that crisis? Sure. And did that have any impact on your sales?
So NBFC crisis, so you can look at the NBFC crisis from two perspectives. One perspective is that you can look at it from a perspective wherein this unorganized developers, which Ronak was talking about, they kept on getting funding even though when they were not able to do the sales. So it was basically a process of, it was a process wherein the consolidation was getting elongated, the process was getting stretched. When the NBFC crisis happened, basically the liquidity for all these NBFCs who were funding these unorganized developers at a slightly higher cost of funding basically vanished. And that is when the real consolidation started in the real estate sector. For us per se, it has not affected us at all. In fact, my credit rating from Fitch and one of the local rating agencies, CARE, has gone up. We are today a AA category company. There are only 5 to 6 companies in the AA category in India. Out of that, only 2 companies are of first generation entrepreneur. That is Suntec Realty and Oberoi Realty. The rest 3 are the Tatas, the Godrej, and the Mahindras, wherein the credit rating is supported by the parentage comfort. So for us, it has actually helped us to showcase our strength even in a much more positive way. We have recently done borrowings from top banks of the country in single digits. So that is something wherein you are seeing now bankers also trying to work with quality names. They are ready to sacrifice on their margins, but they want to work with quality names wherein they are assured that their money will come back to them. So all in all, it has been a good time for us. In fact, we launched one of our biggest township projects during the NBFC crisis. We launched close to 2,500 units, and out of that, we sold around 2,000 units. So it has been good for us all in all.
And I think just for the general context of everybody here, I'll just talk a little more about how the crisis sort of emerged. I think that will just That's help to build some context. Yes. So what was happening was the NBFCs were lending.
Non-banking
financial institutions. They were lending to real estate players, unorganized as well as organized. And of course, you know, there were business plans where, you know, there was speculative pricing assumed and cash flow visibility didn't happen. So there was a lot of refinancing happening. It was technically, you know, in layman terms, it was like passing the parcel. So while I would be at 50% LTV, you would come in and refinance me. And, you know, the asset value hasn't increased mm-hmm. because the project hasn't started generating cash flows. Correct. So the LTV in every round of refinance just kept going up. And they reached a breaking point where without any cash flow visibility, I think the NBFCs sort of didn't see their principal coming back, and that is when this liquidity squeeze really happened. And the reason why this sort of trend developed is because NBFC started charging a high processing fee upfront, which they would book in that same quarter. So people were incentivized to have that on their P&L, which is immediate fees, right? That sort of pays for the bonuses and the salary. And that is what incentivized the NBFCs to keep doing it until the situation which has happened and everyone's aware. So I think that is where the NBFC crisis sort of emerged within in the Indian real estate segment.